I'm from L.A. I viewed L.A. as a native. I never saw it as a strange land chronicled by outside writers. I grew up there. I sifted data and transfigured it kid style. It was diverse shit. The connecting threads were corruption and obsession. Kitty Noir was my métier. I lived in the film noir epicenter during the film noir era. Geography is destiny. My parents hatched me in a cool locale. I got dropped in L.A., the film noir epicenter, at the height of the film noir era. Film noir was filmed here largely because the movie studios are here and it was cheap to shoot on location here. It's really just happenstance and monetary concern that has led L.A. to being the film noir place.
I want to report a murder.
Sit down. Where was this murder committed?
San Francisco, last night.
Who was murdered?
I was.
Here's a story that illustrates Kitty Noir for me. And it also illustrates my very, very early alcoholism. Around Christmas in 1957, when I was 9 years old, my old man took me to see a movie on Hollywood Boulevard. Right after that, my old man took me for a stroll along Hollywood Boulevard. We went north on Cherokee, and he parked my 9-year-old ass down on the front stoop of a building. He did what he always did. He gave me a pat on the head, a comic book, and said, "Don't roam. Kid, I'm going inside to see a friend." Well, he was going inside to see one of his numerous bitches, the biches. What did I do? I sat there and I skimmed my comic book and I noticed a half full bottle of red wine, uncorked. I drank it all. Something said, "Drink the booze." And I went window peeping. I went looking for women in windows. I was 9 years old. I'm not a noir writer. I've written a series of books, The L.A. Quartet, The Black Dahlia, The Big Nowhere, L.A. Confidential, and White Jazz, that were set in L.A. during the film noir era, specifically 1946 to 1958. The noir construction is a kernel within them. Sexual obsession. What happens when you meet a woman and it goes bad? Political corruption. Extreme ambition and its moral consequences.
Film noir is sort of the anti-myth. You know, Hollywood, in a sense, was created to sell people the idea of happily ever after. And I think film noir is the flip side of that. It's not going to end well. You can't count on a happy ending. The dream isn't always going to come true.
Mr. Brown, tell him not to do it. I'll do anything you want. I'll go away. You'll never see me again. Please, Mr. Brown, don't just stand there and let him kill me. Please, Mr. Brown, I don't want to die. Tell him. Please tell him.
I feel sorry for you, Joe. So I'm going to do you a favor. You won't hear the bullets.
The general thinking is that somehow, because these films, all most of the films, appeared at right after the Second World War, that somehow the films were a response to the Second World War. I don't actually believe that's true. I believe that they were a response to the Great Depression in America, because most of the great stories that became noir were written during the 1930s, and they were commentaries on the state of America in the 1930s. They only made it to the screen in the late 1940s. Part of the reason was because Hollywood had to do its patriotic duty during the war and keep morale high. You know, there were a lot of propaganda films, you know, about the strength of the American character during World War II. But then after the war, it was like we could breathe this sigh of relief that, okay, we won. We've kept the world safe. Now we can actually take a little more serious look at who we are and these unfinished issues that were left over from the 1930s, where we had basically done it to ourselves. And this is really where noir was essential, in that it allowed artists to explore themes and characters that were sort of off limits when Hollywood was responsible for moral uplift.
How could I have known that murder can sometimes smell like honeysuckle?
I can't stand it anymore. What if they did hang me?
They're not going to hang you, baby.
It's better than going on this way.
They're not going to hang you because you're going to do it and I'm going to help you.
You're fucked. It's like this. You meet a woman and all of a sudden life takes on a glow. But she's demonic and she wants you to kill her husband. And you're going to be in the gas chamber in 6 months for either whacking a husband or for a crime because she set you up that you didn't really commit. But it's okay, because what did you really want when you fell for the woman? You wanted your options narrowed down to a comprehensible few.
You don't know Keyes. Once he gets his teeth into something, he never lets go. He'll investigate you. He'll have you shattered. He'll watch every minute from now on. Afraid, baby?
Yes, I'm afraid. But not of Keyes. I'm afraid of us.
Personally, I dig this shit. Personally, there's times I wish I could meet a woman and be in the gas chamber in 6 months. God knows I've tried. Usually what happens is it blows apart. Yeah, and then you're left howling, wailing in the night. And noir is the most scrutinized offshoot of the hard-boiled school of fiction. It's the long drop off the short pier and the wrong man and the wrong woman in perfect misalliance. It's the nightmare of flawed souls with big dreams and the precise how and why of the all-time sure thing that goes bad. Noir's opportunity is fatality, social justice is a sanctified chuck, and sexual love as a one-way ticket to hell. So we all know what the style is of film noir. German expressionism, shadows, high contrast, photography, the sense that you're in a dream state. Is this really happening or is it not? The films are photographed to give you a greatened, heightened sense of displacement. You feel swept away as you watch the films. You're inside somebody's dream or somebody's nightmare. It's all about the big fuck up. And the great theme of both Roman noir and film noir is you're fucked.
I killed Dietrichson. Me, Walter Neff. Insurance salesman, 35 years old, unmarried, no visible scars. Until a while ago, that is. Yes, I killed him. I killed him for money and for a woman.
Double Indemnity was the one that triggered it all, because it took big stars and it made them the villains, which opened up Pandora's box in a very positive way for artists. You know, Barbara Stanwyck was afraid to play that part, like, my fans will hate me. And Billy Wilder just challenged her and said, you know, I thought you were an actress. And it changed everything. And Fred McMurray was a comedian who was suddenly a murderer. And, you know, in the film's depiction of Los Angeles as this bright and sunny place where opportunity is endless, but then you walk in the house and it's this dark, shadowy, very corrupt world where people are capable of anything. In a way, Double Indemnity just sort of crystallizes exactly what noir was all about. And the fact that it's set in Los Angeles is perfect. Then later on, when he makes Sunset Boulevard, it's a grotesque version of what he is subtly depicting in Double Indemnity. Sunset Boulevard is a perfect movie. The way he is able to find these baroque, but not completely over-the-top ways of depicting what Hollywood is all about, and the corruption of it, the sadness of it, but the enticement of it. Again, it's an amazing film because you empathize with all the characters.
Has it ever occurred to you that I may have a life of my own, that there may be some girl that I'm crazy about?
Who? Some car hop or dress extra?
What I'm trying to say is that I'm all wrong for you. You want a Valentino, somebody with polo ponies, a big shot.
What you're trying to say is you don't want me to love you. Say it. Say it.
Because there are many references made in the film to people coming to Los Angeles to achieve the dream, and the city, in many ways, is synonymous with film noir.
Why don't you try? Go ahead.
Here in Los Angeles, you walk down a street, you turn a corner, you go from normal life to something that's turned upside down. And that's the thing that's really interesting about Los Angeles as an urban landscape. It's eclectic, it's got spaces that are somewhat open, and it's got spaces downtown here that, yeah, are as constricted as New York. It's a vast sort of panorama of possibilities. And the people that made film noir, this was their backyard. You have filmmakers focusing essentially, and the concepts of film noir developing in the late 20s and early 30s, when Los Angeles was a very dark place in terms of its politics, and in terms of its social dynamism. The police department and the other political organizations in Los Angeles answered to whoever had the most money. And it wasn't until a succession of scandals exposed the corruption to the city's sunshine that really there was sufficient impetus to make changes. The writers who came to Los Angeles then, who were here from Horace McCoy and Hammett, to most notably Raymond Chandler, saw this change. Chandler often referred to Los Angeles in diverse terms. It was a big, dry, sunny place. It was a city that needed Hollywood to have more personality than a paper cup. But it was also a city full of what he called dark streets. And in his famous phrase, it was down these dark streets that a man must go. I drove onto the Oxnard Cutoff and turned back along the ocean. On the right, the great, fat, solid Pacific, trudging into shore like a scrub woman going home. No moon, no fuss, hardly a sound of the surf. No smell, none of the harsh, wild smell of the sea. You're not human tonight, Marlowe. Malibu, more movie stars, more pink and blue bathtubs, more tufted beds, more Chanel No. 5, more Lincoln Continentals and Cadillac. I smelled Los Angeles before I got to it. It smelled stale and old, like a living room that had been closed too long. But the colored lights fooled you. The lights were wonderful. There ought to be a monument to the man who invented neon lights. 15 stories high, solid marble. There's a boy who really made something out of nothing. What's interesting is that the hard-boiled writers had a particular view of the West Coast, saw it as different, most markedly in terms of the emotions of the people that live there, more proletarian, less rigid, but at the same time, as I said, really more paranoid, less established, so more caught in a social flux, more uncertain about their futures. And it's this sensibility that the writers who started in the 20s and 30s saw in the West Coast that carried over into the noir movement and colored it significantly in terms of its underlying emotion. Film noir is about threat. It's about unforeseen disruptive events. It's about characters who are paranoid, some without reason, but a lot of them because the paranoia is warranted.
Can I help you, sir?
Oh, yeah, I'm looking for a good mystery on something off the beaten track like the Maltese Falcon.
Well, that was a fascinating story. But here's one that has everything the Falcon had and more. It's Raymond Chandler's latest bestseller, The Big Sleep. What a picture that'll make.
Mind if I look at it? Huh. Sometimes I wonder what strange fate brought me out of the storm to that house that stood alone in the shadows. As I probed into its mysteries, every clue told me a different story. But each had the same ending, murder.
Chandler wrote the kind of man that he wanted to be. Gallant, suffused with a satirist's keen eye and a chivalric knight's noble notions.
I like that. I'd like more. Even better.
Hammett's vision of this kind of man, the detective, is darker than Raymond Chandler's.
What have you ever given me beside money? Have you ever given me any of your confidence, any of the truth? Haven't you tried to buy my loyalty with money and nothing else?
What else is there I can buy you with?
Hammett's hero is the male figure in American society. He is primarily a worker and a job holder. He goes at his job with a bloodthirsty determination which stems from an unwillingness to go beyond it. The whole issue of good and evil means nothing to him.
We were talking about a lot more money than this.
There are more of us to be taken care of now.
Well, that may be, but I've got the Falcon.
You may have the Falcon, but we certainly have you.
Sam Spade changed everything because he was truly an anti-hero, because he did nothing for the benefit of society. He was not operating for the greater good of anything. He was operating for himself. An important aspect of noir and what it allowed America to consider on the big screen for the first time was the idea of failure. It's not all going to work out. There's a really good chance that I'm going to try my best and I'm going to fail. And obviously, this being Hollywood, it's so much more compelling when the person who fails is Burt Lancaster or Robert Mitchum or some incredibly indomitable looking man. And especially if they succumb to a woman.
I'm scared. They're killers. Killers. I can't even sleep. Look the way he treats me.
saw the danger signs, but he wouldn't heed them. For him, there was no way out. He couldn't drop her. She was in his mind, in his blood. And if loving her meant tangling with a killer, he was ready for that too.
The woman will require more and more of your essential biologically driven masculinity, and in the end, you will be helplessly immobilized. That's Burt Lancaster, led to the armored car heist by his duplicitous ex-wife, Yvonne Carlo, in Crisscross. That's Robert Mitchum and Jane Greer in Out of the Past. That's Fred McMurray and Barbara Stanwyck in Double Indemnity. As a construction that talks about people, that talks specifically about men and women, put the misogynistic aspect aside, I dig it.
You can be so sweet at times. Oh dear, I must rush.
Film noir is the only type of film made at that period in Hollywood where the women were completely the equal of men, where they were allowed to be the equal of men. They are equally tempted, they are equally compromised, and they are equally guilty. Jean Simmons, beautiful, sweet little English gal, when she made Angel Face, that's like a freak show. She's just very, very scary in that movie. Jean Tierney in Leave Her to Heaven, you know, she plays this apparently very angelic character in Laura that everybody falls in love with, but then she makes Leave Her to Heaven, and I don't know if there's a more psychotic female role in all of movies than her in Leave Her to Heaven.
I hate the little beast. I wish it would die. Ellen. Shocked, aren't you? If you were having the baby, you'd love it. Well, I never wanted it. Richard and I never needed anything else. Now this.
How can you say such wicked things?
Sometimes the truth is wicked.
I don't personally like any of the film fatales in film noir because I go for wholesome looking women. I don't like the affect of cigarettes and red nails and plunging necklined gowns. I like the good women of film noir. I like Ella Raines, who works in a gas station above San Francisco.
Sure. It's a hobby of mine.
Start her up. Okay, start her up.
Who are some others who come to mind? Phyllis Kirk in Crime Wave, Avec Sterling Hayden.
I love you. I wanted you, and now that I've got you, I care a lot less.
I can't figure it. What do you see in a guy like me?
I see a guy who's swell, who's kind and strong. That's what I see.
I like Virginia Houston in Out of the Past, who's the good woman that Robert Mitchum leaves behind, rather than Jane Greer as the seductress. These are my women. I'm a wholesome cat underneath it all, and I want to go out and have the fucking adventures and then come home to these women who may reveal some dark appetites, you know, to me after it says the end at the end of the movie.
Your Honor, in view of the evidence presented, we now ask for a dismissal of the state's case against Walter Williams. And we intend to charge Irene Williams with conspiracy to commit murder against her husband, Walter Williams.
Oh, no!
You will see in almost every movie where a femme fatale is depicted, there is another woman in the story who is her antithesis.
Well, that's that, Walt.
Congratulations, Mr. Williams.
I haven't the words for it, Quincy, but we... we could never have made it without you.
Ah, sure you could. You know, son, right always wins if you give it a little push, especially when you get a copper like this one to do the pushing.
That woman, I guarantee you, 100% of the time, works for a living and is self-sufficient. She is a nurse, she's an artist, she's a designer, she's a magazine editor. She doesn't necessarily have a man in her life, and she is totally self-sufficient. And to me, that's the astounding thing in these movies is, okay, on one level, oh, look, they're depicting the women again as these evil beings that just want to destroy men. Well, yeah, but look at level two. They're showing you that the only way the man can be saved is by going with the woman who is self-sufficient and is a viable part of the workforce, which is a pretty amazing point to be made in 1948, 49 in the United States.
Laura had innate breeding.
I selected a more attractive hairdress for her. I taught her what clothes were more becoming to her. Through me, she met everyone. Men admired her. Women envied her.
You have rarely met a girl like Laura. Few women have been so beautiful, so exotic, so dangerous to know.
For years, I've been trying to get the assignment to write the remake of Laura. The construction is the greatest in Roman noir and film noir. A woman is murdered. She's a society woman. Her face is blasted off. And a lonely, haunted, handsome young policeman is assigned to investigate the murder. There's a portrait of Laura that's hung up in the place where she was killed. He falls in love with the portrait. Laura Hunt turns up alive and they fall in love. Turns out another woman was murdered. He solves the crime. It's everything I've ever felt and everything I've ever thought about women and crime and redemption.
You better watch out, McPherson, or you'll end up in a psychiatric ward. I don't think they've ever had a patient who fell in love with a corpse.
It's one step up from necrophilia, and he was very well cast. Dana Andrews looks like a lower evolutionary creature. And he's scowling. He looks at the portrait, and he's Beethoven. The look on his face is perpetually, Laura, I want you. Oh, Laura Hunt is my woman. And I identify with this. I would fall in love with a portrait of a woman and burn my life down to be with a woman, whether she was real or not. That's just me. L.A., come on vacation, go home on probation. That line implies that L.A. is a magnetic field and that all L.A. migrations are suspect. That line indicts your desire to come to L.A. and categorizes you as an opportunist with a hidden sexual agenda. That line is a cliche and a prophecy. You can blame your fall and retreat on the city that magnetized you and duck the issue of your own failure. People will understand and empathize. They know that LA is big, bad, and beautiful and full of the power to mortify. The movies were shot here. They were shot downtown, and one location stands in definitively. It's used in Crisscross, it's used in DOA, it's used in dozens of others. And it's City Hall, which was the fount of city government here in Los Angeles, then as now. It's a spire. It's a phallic symbol. The LAPD Detective Bureau was on the sixth floor there. You can see it in Crime Wave, directed by Andre de Toth, with Sterling Hayden.
When the light goes down and the city is dark, its back streets and brooding alleys become a jungle, and its denizens stretch out their claws of violence from the shadows. That's where I come in. Sims, homicide. Because murder is my business, and midnight is my beat. And it takes me to the real story behind a thousand front page headlines. Sometimes to the savage fury of a report that begins when a man's life is ended. And so the word goes out along the city's vast network of communication. Killers loose, ready to kill again, dragging innocent lives with them in a reckless pattern of flight as they try to hide in a city stripped naked where there is no escape. But the wheels of the law's machinery grind hard and the long arms of the department stretch out, girdling the city, drawing the steel net tighter and tighter.
And you can see it in He Walked by Night. It's the place where the themes cohere. It's where the suspects are brought. It's where the cops kick the shit out of them with phone books. It's where the ride to the green room at San Quentin Prison begins. The theme of official misconduct, the perversion of justice, the railroaded suspect, the frame job, the brutal cop with a perverted sexual agenda, the innocent guy in love with the bad woman caught up in the police dragnet. It all happens at City Hall. And after a while, in the late 40s and early 50s, City Hall at night was used as a framing device. You instantly know where you are when City Hall is shown.
When you watch these films, you do realize that so many of the interiors are not shot in these actual places, except the Bradbury Building, which is a famous Los Angeles location. And Joseph Losey and M, I think, made the best use of the Bradbury Building ever. It's also in Double Indemnity. It's also in DOA, it's part of DOA. It's shot in the Bradbury Building. There weren't a tremendous amount of noirish locations in Los Angeles because they always went back to the Bradbury Building. They always went back to the same places. They always used Angel's Flight, the old funicular trolley that went up Bunker Hill. That's like a signature. That's like signing the film. This is an L.A. noir because there's the trolley, you know, which has been used in a lot of films very effectively. Like Act of Violence, which I think is like one of the most perfect noir films ever made.
Look, I want to talk to you about an act of violence. My name is Van Heflin, and I'd like you to put yourself in my place. You're an ordinary guy, so you're doing pretty well. You've got a girl that you love. And then, without warning, out of your past comes a man who used to be your best friend. And when you look in his eyes, you find nothing but hate, menace, and murder. And because of what you did once, there's nothing you can do now. You try to get away, but you know deep down in your heart that everything is going to end in this sudden blinding flash of a .45.
The context of post-war film noir is ambiguously defined. It was a tremendous party atmosphere in America. Here in Los Angeles, you had a lot of whacked out psycho, Army, Marine Corps, Navy, Air Corps vets coming back and pulling whacked out misogynistic stunts. Assaults on women went up dramatically in the post-war era here in Los Angeles. You had a lot of auspiciously unsolved murders of women, Elizabeth Short, the Black Dahlia, chief among them, and you have a sense of LA as going nuts. It's prosperous. It's building up and out. There are jobs for everyone. Drug addiction, la mota, heroin, on the rise, pill poppers, on the rise, bebop, black jazz, bebop, discordant, edgy, the committed music of black hepcat junkies, is on the rise.
Go on, go on, go on. Get it, Christian.
They're really just stories of crime, but within those stories of crime, a social critique. And there are some emblematic film noir actors. My two favorite are the sweaty, gangrenous, putrid little hustler, Edmund O'Brien, the noir arriviste, and the tall, imperiously stern-looking, and handsome, self-pitying psychopath, Robert Ryan. You got Robert Ryan in On Dangerous Ground. You've got Robert Ryan in Act of Violence. You've got him much later, in 1959, in Odds Against Tomorrow. You've got him as the anti-Semite killer in Crossfire, and he reeks of self-pity. Society fucked me over.
What's the matter, Jew boy? You afraid we'll drink up all your stinking wonderful liquor?
Stop it!
You went nuts!
I got
nothing
against
every Jew,
Mommy!
Well, I don't like Jews, and I don't like nobody who likes Jews.
And Edmund O'Brien, fat, squatty, well-dressed, sweaty, in need of a cigarette, in need of a drink, in need of a woman, is too busy trying to score to evince self-pity. He's America's cheap version of itself. He's on the make. He's on the hustle. He wants the women. He wants the booze. He wants the next big deal. I identify with Edmund O'Brien much more than I identify with Robert Ryan. I think there are two emblematic film noirs of the post-war era, one shallow, one deep. The shallow one features Edmund O'Brien. It's DOA, and it's the greatest crazy quilt construction in film noir. He's a dipshit hustler. He's a real estate guy, but he's a notary public, among other things. And back in Banning, California, a crummy little desert community, he notarizes a piece of paper. Then he goes off, leaving his long-suffering girlfriend behind, to San Francisco to booze and chase coups. The booze and the coups have got him by the nuts, and somebody slips radium into his drink at a Hepcat jazz club.
Who's the blonde?
She always comes in alone. Drives a big convertible, wears a mink coat, but knows everybody. But she always comes in alone.
That's full of sweating, bebopping, horn honking, sax blatting, black jazz musicians, and a good-looking slinky blonde who keeps going, "Blast me, baby," every time she wants a drink.
Give me a blast, Leo.
Leo, I left my blast at the other end of the bar.
So he gets poisoned. And the poison is slow acting. He's got a week to live, and he goes out to find the guys who killed him. And it's all, you're fucked, because it all comes down to something he hardly recalls doing. Bam, putting a notary public seal on a piece of paper. That is malign fate, fallibility, the booze and the coups, the search for the woman, the get-out-of-town mystique, the long-suffering girlfriend back in the hick burg. That's one part of film noir.
All I did was notarize a bill of sale.
How shall I make out the report on him, Captain?
Better make it dead on arrival.
Then there's Out of the Past, where the man goes to Mexico to meet a woman.
And then I saw her coming out of the sun. And I knew why Witt didn't care about that 40 grand.
He's got to bring her back for Kirk Douglas, who she shot, who she stole $40,000 from. And it's a fait accompli. Right at the get-go, they're going to fall in love.
You are taking me back.
There's no hurry.
I could have run away last night.
I'd find you.
Yes, I believe you would.
But early on in that movie, the first 45 minutes, it's nothing but fate reaching back into the recent past and male susceptibility to women.
One chance in a million. One chance in a million was all that chump ever had in his life, and he made it good. I went alone to L.A., and I made it easy for him to follow me. We'd played it smart and forgotten nothing. Forgotten nothing except one thing.
You may die. Doesn't matter.
Beat it.
Because I want my options narrowed down to a comprehensible few. And even if the woman turns out to be evil and I wind up dead the way Robert Mitchum does at the end of that movie, or if I'm railroaded to the green room for a crime I did not commit, or even if I whack the woman's husband, what the fuck? There was the woman in the interim.
The Big Combo, which is a Joseph H. Lewis film. He also made Gun Crazy. And it's just an amazing film because what interests me about it is how it cuts to the quick about American character and how the villain is the most attractive character in the movie. He is absolutely reprehensible, but he is undeniably attractive. This character played Mr. Brown, played by Richard Conte.
This is Mr. Brown.
The failure of the cop to bring this guy down turns the cop into a very unlikable character who succumbs to like this neurotic obsession to destroy this criminal.
Mr. Brown is a very reasonable man. You don't know him.
Oh, is he? Well, I'm not. And I intend to make life very difficult for your Mr. Brown.
You shouldn't talk like that, Lieutenant. You're overstepping your authority.
Joe, the man has reason to hate me. His salary's $96.50 a week. The busboys in my hotel make better money than that.
Film noir, Roman noir, is the story of masculinity and duress, so it would be incomplete without a homosexual text. There are the lovers Lee Van Cleef and Earl Holliman in The Big Combo, where Earl Holliman says, no, I don't like this all salami diet.
Gotta eat some.
Can't swallow any more salami.
That's all we've got.
Where is Brown? When's he coming?
I didn't get it the first couple of times I saw it. In fact, had to have it pointed out to me.
This is one of those movies where, are they really saying this? Because the two hitmen are clearly gay. And I remember I showed this movie years ago and I had Earl Holliman, the actor who plays one of the two hitmen. And when I brought up the fact that the gay hitmen, and he looked at me like he was shocked. He goes, "You got that?" Because they really thought that like nobody in 1956 was ever going to recognize this.
When we get out, let's never come back, huh?
What I'm worried about is getting out of this hotel. The cops will be looking for us in every closet.
And there's a scene where Richard Conte is with Gene Wallace, where he slinks down out of the frame while he's kissing her, and the inference is that he is continuing to do this below the waist. And the camera stays on her, and she's reacting, and it's like, wow. That is the most overt depiction of, you know, oral sex in a movie ever in Hollywood. And it was indicative of how the process worked back then, because the filmmakers would do something like that creatively and then challenge the censors at the production code office to recognize what it was that they were depicting. And if it wasn't shown explicitly, they could say, wow, really? You see that? What's wrong with you? You must have a sick mind if you think that's what that is. So a lot of these Irish Catholic guys who were the censors would see it and were afraid to say, I know what that means. They didn't want to admit it, you know?
Put the blame on Maine, boy. Put the blame on Maine.
And Gilda, you know, which made a superstar of Rita Hayworth, has this incredibly strange bisexual relationship with the two men in that movie. And I will tell you a funny story. I was very good friends with Evelyn Keyes, who was married to Charles Vidor, the director of Gilda. And one of the great experiences of my life as a cinephile was watching Gilda with her. And she went through that film and like pointed out every bit of sexual symbolism and said, oh, that's so much like Charles, you know? And he pulls the little sword out and he's, oh, could you be more explicit with the phallic symbol, you know? And then, oh, and this is his symbol for oral sex. And it was hysterical. And it's like, really? And it's, oh yeah, when she bends down and smokes, you know, lights the cigarette down, and he's holding the lighter like down by his belt buckle. And she's like, oh yeah, that's, Charles was a big fan of that.
Into the 60s, sort of after The Last Stragglers, the movement ends. And then neo-noir starts, which is consciously mimicking the style of classic period. There are a lot of preeminent filmmakers who are lovers of the classic period, who make neo-noir, you know, Walter Hill, Michael Mann, preeminent examples of sort of self-conscious filmmakers that reflect back on the classic period, that continue to use Los Angeles in a particularly expressive way. I think what's also interesting is that Los Angeles introduced these possibilities to the makers of early television, and in, not just in Dragnet or the shows that derived from the classic period noir, but the possibilities of shooting here expressively continued throughout the 60s and 70s and were another influence on American filmmakers.
You'll see this later when Polanski makes Chinatown. It's the exact same principle, right? We're just following the detective through all these different social strata, that you're experiencing what makes up the whole city through one man's journey.
Go home, Jake. I'm doing you a favor.
Forget it, Jake. It's Chinatown.
The Long Goodbye is a great example of... I know a lot of people hate that movie. A lot of fanatical Raymond Chandler fans hate The Long Goodbye because Elliot Gould is not their idea of Philip Marlowe. But I think the film is fantastic because Elliot Gould embodies the transition of Chandler's moral code to a new era in Los Angeles. And it's like, well, if you're really gonna have that code in this new version of LA, this is kind of how you're gonna go about it, and this is sort of what you're gonna look like, you know? Don't bother me, you know, it's not my problem, you know? Because the world had just passed Marlowe by, you know? But it is, I think, a very, very vivid and valid depiction of Los Angeles in the 70s. Maybe the best one.
Your name, Marlowe?
No, my name is Sidney Jenkins.
Come on, let's go inside, Marlowe. We want to talk to you.
Oh, is this where I'm supposed to say, what is all this about? And he says, shut up, I ask the questions.
Yeah, that's right, Marlowe.
My secret L.A. obliterated the outer L.A. I've been living in it for many, many years. I've reconstructed L.A. in the 50s in my head and on paper. I have lived in the literal L.A. and dreamed my own private L.A. L.A. Confidential is the largest novel in my L.A. quartet. It shows the city being built. It shows L.A. at its boomtown apex. What I did was take a central crime that I tore from recent headline and transposed it to 1953, and then I grabbed here, there, and elsewhere from big events of LA's 1950s. This is my big road-mapped novel of Los Angeles during the 1950s. That it was made into a greatly reduced, coherent, dramatically fine motion picture was nothing but a godsend to me.
The Night Owl Massacre. This is a heinous crime that requires swift resolution. Six victims. One of them, one of our own.
New York noir is obvious, right? It's tenements, it's your too many rats in the cage. That's the story, okay? But in Los Angeles, it's more subtle because it's the wide open spaces. It's sunny. But having said that, it makes the darker aspects all the more bitter because you've been led to believe in something else. And then that's whisked away and this rot is revealed beneath, right? And they're still making that story today. You know, David Lynch's Mulholland Drive is one of the great noir, contemporary noir films specifically about Los Angeles.
It was pure LA. It was bravura LA for one reason. I denied the existence of non-LA shit. Because I'm from there. Because I thought LA was everywhere. Because I was that xenophobic and self-absorbed. Because I knew my weird shit was the best weird shit alive. Because you don't smear your hometown with outside writers' perceptions. Because LA's weird shit is the best weird shit on earth. And I grew up when it flourished prosaic. I'm 66 years old, man. I'm closer to the end of this than anybody in this room, and I feel like I got 30 years to engage institutional corruption, sexual obsession, meeting women, getting strong-armed by LAPD, getting railroaded to the gas chamber. You know, bring it on. It ain't over yet.